On the interview there, Swindles no doubt will be looking very buff after this. We do have a new panel that has joined us for our third series. Two returnees and one brand new man, so we'll introduce them. Welcome back to the panel, Alan. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Yeah. This is going to be one heck of a series.
It is, isn't it? What are you looking forward to most?
I think this is a great matchup. Liquid, obviously a team that a lot of us had picked to finish very high here. You look at their numbers, they're top three in the tournament in average kills, assists, KAD, GPM, XPM. They're dotting the I's, crossing the T's. But you look back to the group stage and these two teams played. It was 2-1 Liquid, and all three games were a 2K net worth advantage or less at the 20-minute mark. Fnatic matches up very well against what Team Liquid do.
Mm. What are you looking forward to, Fogged, in this series?
I'm looking forward to basically exactly what you're saying. They match up really well versus them, and they're not afraid to give Liquid their heroes. They gave Liquid like in all three of those games. So I want to see if they're not afraid at all. Are they just going to give Liquid whatever they want and just play against it? So I want to see if they're looking for either an adaptation or just, you know what, we're just going to beat you straight up. Mm.
Purge, are you good at roof repairs?
Am I going to root for players?
Roof repairs. I just wonder because, you know, DJ coming out to this crowd.
Okay.
I think we might need a new roof.
I mean, depends how close it is, really. And that's what I'm most concerned about is what is the state of the teams?
Yeah.
Liquid lost in winner bracket. Are they going to continue 2-0-ing? Is Fnatic going to be able to recover from getting 2-0'd from Newbie? I mean, that was an interview before they even started.
Yeah.
On the main stage. So is morale the same there as it is now? And I think that's the question that we'll have to see.
All right. Mm-hmm. Plenty of questions and plenty of answers coming up very shortly. But we do need our teams to the arena. Hold yourselves for this one. Brace it. It's Fnatic who are coming out alongside Team Liquid.
The pride of Southeast Asian Dota. Brothers in Arms Ohio and Mushi are veterans of the pro circuit who have stood the test of time. Sacrifices were made to reach this point, but by placing their faith in the ability of newcomers Mid1 and 343, the duo may have masterminded their strongest roster to date. Welcome on stage, Fnatic! Silent but deadly, much like their team captain, Kuroki, this is a squad of reserved players with a formidable playstyle. Hyper-aggressive, against even the stiffest opposition, they overwhelm their enemies. They are the European team of the moment. They come to Manila on the back of three consecutive grand finals. They are the definition of all for one and one for all. Welcome on stage, Team Liquid!
Set for our final series of the day here on day four of the Manila Major. Two more days to go and just five more matches after this one to determine the third major champion. We'll focus on the two sides right now by starting with Fnatic. Alan, they've played well so far, but it'll all be for nothing if they don't win this one.
Yeah, they have a lot on their shoulders. I think this is a really intriguing matchup for them because of the contrast in styles. Liquid very structured, very disciplined in their approach. Fnatic play a little bit more by feel, but they're able to bring five heroes from to engagements in these big fights from angles you don't expect, much the way Team MVP were able to beat Liquid the other day. In terms of players to look for, first one I would say is Mid1. Mid1 had absolutely two very, very rough games against Liquid in that matchup in the group stage we talked about earlier. He had 10 deaths on his Ember Spirit, and he had an offlane Nyx in Game 3. But of course, on the main stage, there's another player, Purge, that's taken over.
Yeah, it's probably going to be DJ. Is that what you're alluding
to? Oh,
yeah. Okay, yeah. He was the reason that they won versus LGD. It was his black holes, his counter-initiations, his roaming on Earth Spirit from the beginning of the game to the end. He makes huge plays on their team, creates space, and wins games.
Yeah, absolutely. And he is, of course, the crowd favorite. More so than anywhere on planet Earth right now is a Filipino playing in front of his home crowd. So let's find out more about him.
I'm scared people might just say this Filipino guy is like doing this stuff when he's going to lose. He was honestly a no-name before he went to Korea, and even when he went to Korea, a lot of people looked down on him. I went to Korea on like December 2013. I went there alone. I don't know what to do. He had a really, really difficult experience in Korea, financial difficulties, being away from the family.
I did work abroad before, so I know how hard it is. I told him, is it okay for you to go? So he was saying, yes, of course, Mom, let me try this.
That time we always lose in tournaments, and we were really trying hard to win. We're like really hungry to win.
He had this 1 week in Rave that, you know, because the prize money haven't came in and they had no salary because they were unsponsored. They had eggs for food for like a week straight.
Morning, I cook egg. A dinner, different kind of egg.
For DJ, joining our team was a very good opportunity for him to be able to be exposed to the international scene when he was in Rave. You can see that this guy was the one of the main reasons why they were really, really good.
I think he made the right decision to be a professional gamer from the Philippines, because right now he's like the number one pro gamer here in our country, and he gave the country some kind of pride.
Whenever the commentators saying my son's name and they're saying, oh, DJ, what a marvelous game of DJ. So I know he's a very good player.
When I was in Rave, we won 5th place on DAC. We earned a lot of money there, and me and my friends planned to invest it.
I decided to invest in a LAN gaming shop called TNC. He's earning a very, very good sum from the stake that he's got.
I want to cry because I want to tell them, oh, that's my son, and he's really making me proud, so proud.
It's great. I mean, he supports his family. He rented an apartment for them from the money, and then he's just giving back to his family, which is like, really nice.
For all ages, a lot of people play Dota here, and for them, DJ is like some kind of a hero.
None of the Philippine players ever had joined so many international tournaments, and being the star of the team, he's been shining through all of our games, and many people call him the best player in Southeast Asia.
Pride of a nation. A player with an awful lot of expectation on his shoulders, but Fogged, we think he can cope with this.
Yeah, he definitely can. He's proven that even though the crowd here is explosive for him, he's there to show them, you know what, you guys give me the energy. You guys make it even more so possible for me to just make those big plays. And we saw it coming out, of course, from the Enigma, which was spectacular. He broke multiple records. Oh. There's really not much else to say about the guy. He feeds off of their energy.
I mean, the clutchest tournament performance of the tournament so far. Yes. 33 heroes hit with 10 black holes. I know I've said that stat before up here, but there's never been anything close to that in professional Dota 2. And I really do believe that for Fnatic to win this series, they are going to need every big play out of him. They're going to need DJ to be their Dota Jesus.
Okay.
Yeah.
Team Liquid, Purge. Number one ranked team coming into this by pretty much everyone on the planet, including the analysts, including the community votes as well. Lots of pressure on them to perform in the lower bracket because they're not going to get any more mistakes. They can't afford any more.
I think them going to lower bracket was actually good for them, though, because they're the tournament favorite coming in. They got 2-0'd by a super sick performance, and I know that gave them even more drive to win. And they had a lot. They haven't had the big tournament win yet. They keep getting a lot of second places.
They did, and that was a great
tournament. Yep. But they haven't won a major. Haven't won TI, and that's what all those players want. So going to loser bracket, that just put the fire in them, and they haven't lost a game since because their group stage wasn't very good. They kept going 2-1 a lot.
Yeah.
And out of all the teams that I think can absolutely handle that pressure of going to loser bracket, I think Liquid is the one that can take it and become a better team because of it.
Yeah, absolutely. We've been talking about Liquid just with their consistency. You know, they're such a structured team all the time. And now we saw them struggle a little bit from time to time, but now we're starting to see that Liquid that we saw from Epicenter, that dominant team, that just super well-rounded team that is all about, you know, their teamwork. It's not really one player standing out. It's every single one of them doing their role.
Yeah, and I want to pick up on what Purge said because I really do agree with that Liquid has been a slightly different team since they've fallen down to the loser bracket.
Sure.
We talked about last night Fnatic having played 35 different heroes in 10 games. Liquid have actually played 17 different heroes in 4 games since dropping down into that loser's bracket. They've won all 4. They've clearly had some things in reserve. I don't think we've seen this team's best Dota yet.
Okay.
And comparing that to Fnatic, I feel like Fnatic has the better ability to just have an off game. And I don't think it's going to come from DJ necessarily. It could be Mushi picking a weird hero mid, or maybe mid one, reminiscent of how they played versus Liquid the other time. He just got picked off too many times, not necessarily used to those super, super high level ganks around the map with Shadow Blades. So they have to make sure that DJ plays just as well as he normally does, which I expect him to, but everybody on their team has to perform at max level for them to win the set.
Yeah, and then alongside DJ playing mirror image on the other side for Liquid, we need that big game from Jarax as well. He's got to step up and play for his team and bring them what he does so well.
Yeah, you know when you have other teams that are banning around your 4-position support that this is one of the highest impact players in the world. And, of course, Jarax also with the SEA ties, having spent some time last year with MVP Hot 6, going to TI5 with that team, and he has been a different and absolutely dominant player from the support position since then.
Yeah, we're saying that, you know, Liquid is all about their teamwork, but Jarax is one of those players where he's just that playmaker for them. He constantly is going around through all the lanes, just causing havoc throughout the game, and it's going to pay off a lot for them here, and I want to see if he really is able to match versus Jarax.
Okay, we're a few minutes away from the draft. I think we should get predictions from you all right now. I think we're going to put Fogged on the spot first this time and go the other way.
I'm going to have to go Liquid.
Okay, safe bet?
Yeah, I just think that they are, like we've been saying, they're more structured, they're more consistent. Fnatic is a bit all over the place, but they do have their clutch scenario. So I do think they can take a game, but I'm going to have to say Liquid will take the series.
Okay. Alan, just before you make this prediction, you could become an honorary Filipino right now, just with one word.
I can't go against Liquid and the numbers. The thing I want to make clear, okay, I have to pick Liquid here because if you look at their numbers all across the board, they have looked like a tournament favorite, even dropping down early to the loser's bracket. But let me make one thing clear. Fnatic can win this series. They are capable of playing the brand of Dota that MVP used to beat Liquid before.
They're capable, but I don't have as much faith as I have in Liquid performing at their best right now. I think Liquid has the higher chance to win this series. I think it's pretty close, but I would definitely give the favorite to Liquid here.
Okay, so 3 out of 3 for Liquid in terms of the panel right now. Do we have the social media? We do, I think. We'll see
there
that in just
are.
A moment. Yeah, so Fogged.
There they are.
Just
100% Liquid.
Just my fault, that one. Yeah, but we do have Twitch and Twitter votes as well, so let's take a look at the Twitch ones right now. 66-34 in favor of Team Liquid. Twitch chat does not believe this time round. However, it switches round on Twitter. They believe very, very much so. 54-46. I guess that's fairly balanced, isn't it? If you play one off against the other,
yep.
Fairly even. Suggest that it could be an even matchup. You've all said it could be close, Alan in particular.
I mean, it's the arguably statistically the closest series of the tournament so far. You can't argue with that, that Fnatic can match up. I think just all of our comments really about this have been, will Fnatic show up and play their best Dota? If they do, they can absolutely win.
I want to talk about that too, because although Fnatic did have like that incredible showing versus Liquid, I feel like Liquid look at that and they're like, there's no way we're letting that happen again. Like, there's no way we can allow these guys to put us into that position again. So I feel like they're going to learn a lot from that series that they played versus Fnatic earlier.
Yeah, we talk about that a lot, don't we, in terms of GSL brackets. When a team plays a team in the upper bracket and they lose 2-1 and they drop down and then they have to play them again later on in the group, they often win those matchups. Is this a similar situation, although its groups are now a few days, almost a week later?
I think it's similar, but I mean, Liquid did win over Fnatic, but Fnatic put up an immensely good fight. So
yeah.
I'm saying like they have to be looking back at those Fnatic replays like constantly and just being like, what went wrong? What can we improve on? And I think that Liquid will definitely have done that, especially because they have two coaches.
I think Kuroki will definitely have done that. I also want to raise another point about nicely leading from coaches. It's not just coaches that we've got here, it's analysts as well. And there is an analyst, Kips, working for Fnatic right now. What sort of impact can they have on the team?
Well, I think that's one of the things that we're going to see going forward as more and more teams successfully use coaches at these high-level events. There's just the thing that I teach my MBA students, right, is think like a manager. Think in terms of the tasks that you can delegate because there are only so many hours in the day. These coaches, they're looking at replays, they're looking at drafts, they're scouting opponents. They need a support staff behind them to get the team the information they need to make good decisions.
I love seeing this from Fnatic. We've been seeing it every single time they've been on the stage. They all huddle up, they're talking, giving each other a boost in morale, anything they possibly can. You know, it's great to see that they're all like so friendly together as well. Just, it's not just about the game, guys. You know, it's about us.
That's what they need to win.
Yep,
it is.
You were saying as well, Alan, like they're more of a team based on, like, you could say, like, emotions and everything, and just the feel of the game rather than just straight up strategy. So I love seeing teams do that. Just the huddle up.
Yep.
We definitely don't see enough of it here.
Yeah, it's a fairly American sports thing, though, isn't it?
A little bit. And if I look at Liquid, I would say that they're sitting together the last day or two, getting mad that they sucked and lost, is what raises their morale. They're like, we lost, we're better, we're going to win. So even if they don't give the huddle, I think the practice that they surely put in the last couple of days is what Liquid needs as well. To
it's a different way
different
of
approach.
Showing the same thing, effectively. You know, the fire in the belly, as it were, through either the huddle or the general quiet chat that you would imagine that happens with... I always imagine Kuroki just says before we come out, guys, I think we can win this. I think we should just play nice and safely and everything will be fine.
Let's just do what we do best.
That seems to be like his team chat because of just how calm he is in all situations. Even when they won the other day, just came out the booth, very relaxed. I mean, there's a long road for him. Their expectations are much further on than perhaps Fnatic are.
Yeah,
so
every
match matters to Fnatic. Every game matters to them. If it's not the two that we've highlighted, Mid1 and DJ, we're expecting a good series from Mushi as well, aren't we, Alan?
For sure, but...
If they're going
to
win.
If you made me go to a third player, it was actually going to be 3-4-3, because I think the drafts are going to define so much about this series, and his presence sort of directing traffic in these games is going to mean everything. Fnatic have to react to Liquid trying to get these good trades. They have to pick mobility heroes. They need to run their fear around. They need to bring heroes to fights from unexpected locations and try to surprise Liquid into these big fights. That's where I think they're going to generate their advantage.
I'm going to have to actually go with Paul with saying that Mushi is the one who's going to have to, because looking at the games that Fnatic have played, when Mushi kind of struggles in them, the whole team seems to struggle. But when Mushi has pretty much an advantage, they feed off of it. They see him and they're like, wow, you know, our veterans having a good time, we're all going to have a good time, we're all going to play better from that.
Okay.
I think a lot of that as well is that they have to have heroes that can kill heroes and gank heroes, because Liquid has some of the top farming numbers. Mind Control, for example, plays offlane, is not uncommon for him to be the top net worth in a game, even if he's playing Beastmaster. So they have to have the tools and the heroes to be able to get those pickoffs that's going to keep Liquid even or behind.
Lifesteal a ban from Liquid in our first draft and an IO from Fnatic. Nothing outrageous. Do you think Liquid follow the same route Purge as they've been doing, which is banning out specific heroes rather than potential meta heroes?
I feel like the tournament is going that way, with the exception of maybe Lifesteal or IO. Those are pretty commonly played by every team.
Yeah.
They give an advantageous play style, so you have to get them out of the game. But
IO is just now the most banned, by the way. Overtook Beastmaster.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did I put that in my compendium? I think everybody's thinking that right now.
I don't think so.
I had Beastmaster 100%, but actually, I think Beastmaster might come back. And it's interesting that it's actually been the Lifestealer Beastmaster Open that a lot of teams, in fact, Liquid went to twice when they got Lycan and Earth Spirit banned against them yesterday. That Open is just so devastating in terms of its flexibility. I think a lot of teams have realized, though, we're going to start banning the Nakes instead of banning the Beastmaster. Most picked hero of the main event, 66% win rate, stats don't lie.
Keep trying with that one.
Every single time, man. Every single time.
All right, Earth Spirit is in the game.
Earth Spirit's in the game. Fnatic has been picking it a lot lately. They were picking the Disruptor first a lot of the time, and we have been seeing Disruptor having an enormous win rate here up on the main stage. I think over a 70% win rate, up just on the main stage, of course. But it's a support hero that's with that type of win rate is pretty absurd.
Yeah, just that hero has maybe even been more influential than that win rate would suggest. A hero that's had a lot of influence in terms of team positioning, setting up fights, has a way to stop the TP. I do like this open, though, from Fnatic. I think that this is, they need to, especially coming out in game one, I'd like to see them be a little bit more stable. Darkseer, of course, the possibility with the Ember Spirit, and they knew Fnatic did when they drafted this way, they did these bans, they knew they were giving Liquid their Lycan.
Yeah, absolutely. They have a response here. You know, they did the same thing previously. When they played versus Liquid, they gave them the Lycan. They don't really seem to care about playing versus it.
Yep.
And the Sven, though, is the response to the Slardar. Is really clever, right? You're going to have this big amp damage minus armor. Warcry on our whole team.
I think versus both of them, especially. Yep. You know, he's a tanky strength core. Lycan can't really man fight straight up 1v1 versus a Sven. If Sven gets a stun on him, especially now since we've been seeing like the rise of the Echo Saber, he can really just chunk him down in almost one swing.
And he can clear out the Necro 3. Assuming he has a BKB because he has to worry about the damage reflect. But and the movement speed as well from Warcry, it's all around very good against those two heroes.
Absolutely.
Although their ancients can be ganked, though. That's one big thing. They can be blocked, so Sven's opportunity can be mitigated a bit. I said that last time we saw Sven picked, and Sven just killed the offlaner 6 times, and it didn't matter. Yeah. But as long as that doesn't happen, there are tools that you can use against Sven.
There are 11 heroes left in the pool that have a 100% win rate. Many of those have 1 or 2 games on. The two that don't are Sven, who has 5 out of 5, at this tournament, and Lich, that's 6 out of 6. Those are the two.
Wow.
We've got a Sven in the game. It's a good omen.
And it's similar, not exact, but similar to what Fnatic beat Liquid with previously.
Right.
They picked the Darkseer and Kunkka combo, so this is kind of another Wombo combo type lineup that they're building for.
I like this one a lot better than an early Kunkka, though, or a Kunkka at all, because Kunkka is just so countered by a lot of things.
Yeah.
If you miss the initiation, it's over. Glimmer Cape counters the hero a lot. If you miss your boat, it's so easy to miss boat. If you're not initiating from range, it's over. The damage isn't there, and sometimes the rum isn't enough. So.
And I actually have to correct myself. They did end up losing that game versus
the
Liquid
with
the Kunkka mid, but they did put up a huge fight. It ended up going over 50 minutes, which is, you know, a very formidable defense.
Well, but the important thing, and I think you brought this up earlier, was that this is a trend in all 3 games in this group stage. They gave Liquid their Lycan, and they were able to trade against it pound for pound.
Yep. See if it pays off this time, though. We know Matu really loves playing that hero. With his interview, especially, he really focused on that.
And I really love the little things that he does on this hero. He uses his wolves so efficiently. He'll basically often have one wolf following around the initiator from the other team. Often you'll see him farming the jungle with his hero solo just so he can use those wolves for scouting. Really neat, creative ways that he finds to use that hero.
Yeah, we do see, like we were talking about, Disruptor is
a block pick, too.
Yeah, it's a block pick, and it's such a good hero that's been coming out on this main stage. So no surprise to see Liquid pick it up, even though it's a little bit of a change-up from what they usually draft.
It's so good here, too. Like, I love the teamfight mobility they're going to have with Glimpse and Slardar. They can leap in, initiate, they can pull somebody back, kill them while Slardar goes on the back lane. And it's really good in lane against Darkseer, because Darkseer's Surge is essentially worthless now. You just follow him, send him back. and a couple right clicks, and you should be able to kill him.
Super good in lane versus Darkseer, but also they have multiple forms of giving that opportunity for the glimpse. They have the amplified damage, like Alan was pointing out as well. They have the wolves to give the vision constantly, so it just makes the disruptor's life infinitely easier.
Yeah, and this is really the Witch Doctor pick. This has really been an SEA staple. Both Dubu and 343, their Witch Doctor play is incredibly consistent. They've gone away from it, as we mentioned earlier, recently picking the disruptor a little bit more often, but I think they're perfectly comfortable going back to it.
Now, Liquid picking up their, probably saving their Fata hero for last, unless they want to.
Well, DP is still on the table.
So is Urspirit.
Yeah.
But oh, I didn't even.
Yeah, that's a really good point there. Urspirit really for Jerax is still there, and it's a very good one.
Wow.
This game.
Very good right now. Silence against Darkseer, Silence against Witch Doctor, Boulder Smash against both of those is quite good too.
Are you surprised they've left that one there?
I'm a little bit.
Take the Tusk.
Yeah. Jerax Tusk, obviously, we haven't
great.
Seen as much of it recently,
yeah,
but
still great.
Yeah.
But you'd probably fancy you'd want to play against the Tusk rather than the Earth Spirit here, wouldn't you?
I think they've got to have left that in intentionally.
I think.
Though.
Because they've got an answer?
Okay.
Oh, okay.
I really like.
Or are they going to go somewhere else anyway?
I like the Tusk ban, though, because. They're looking at like a type of wombo combo lineup with the Darkseer Sven, so that's one hero that can really mess up everything, because say you do get like a 3 or 4 man like Stormhammer, this Tusk can just grab everybody into the snowball and completely ruin your initiation.
Yeah, could be the same with Kask as well.
Yeah.
If you just get lucky and get two heroes and Sven happens to have God Strength on and is nearby, that could be the end of the fight.
Yep.
Yeah, and this is another reason that I really love Jax's playstyle, that he can turn greedy heroes into aggressive heroes.
Yeah.
You know, you really have this guessing game as Fnatic right now. Is Jax going to play greedy, take that Doom into the jungle, or is he going to focus on more of those early game rotations?
It is a big changeup, though. They haven't picked the Doom yet at all. And now we do have Fnatic picking up the Invoker. Wow. And do you think that would be the Exord or the Quaswex? It's really good Quaswex versus Liquid lineup.
I think
but
you. I would rather see Exord in
probably
this
rather
game.
Exord this game, yeah.
Yeah, they would have pretty weak offense otherwise.
Yeah, they'd
especially
be pretty
in
much
laning.
Just relying on the Sven.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, Sunstrike is a lot easier to land with Sven because he does have a long duration stun, and it helps out the lanes a lot more.
Do you ban the Bounty Hunter as Liquid here? Is that a threat that for Fnatic to take 5?
Depends what mid hero they pick.
Okay, fair enough.
I think Bounty Hunter can go really badly, though, if Fnatic does want to go for it. You are versus a Lycan, so you can get pushed down quite heavily.
True.
But at the same time, it can cause havoc amongst the lanes, so we might see them ban it out.
Yeah, I'm just thinking to retain the option of running that Doom a little bit more greedily in the jungle.
Yeah.
The Bounty Hunter can
yeah,
really play havoc with that. But they are going to go ahead. Liquid are going to ban the Earth Spirit themselves.
And I think we were talking about how when they ban the Earth Spirit, they actually tend to win most of the time as well, which is
okay,
pretty peculiar.
It was definitely the right time. I mean, they already grabbed Doom. They have Slaughter. They would have to do 4 position Slaughter if they wanted to pick another support. So that was definitely the best hero left over. Iron Chill with Earth Spirit in their early game. I'm almost surprised they didn't pick it earlier.
Let me just – I just really want to see Fnatic, YOLO, Enigma pick here. I don't know that it would be the best pick, but I think Liquid goes DP for their final pick or Dragonite, but they're going to go ahead and go Axe. Okay.
So this is something that – they played versus Lycan previously. They picked the Axe, and it's very good versus Lycan. It used to be just as good because of the physical damage, and it's just obnoxious for Lycan to deal with.
Yeah.
But
and there's the DP.
There's the DP like we were talking about. So nothing too out of the ordinary from Liquid except for the Doom.
Slightly different. Purge.
Really even draft.
What do you think?
I think I like Liquid's draft better. They've got all their comfort heroes. And it's Crow playing Doom. I think it'll be fine. So I think Liquid has a better draft here.
I think I'm going to take Liquid, but boy, I think Fnatic have given themselves a pretty good chance to win with this draft.
I'm going to have to go with Liquid as well. Responding with Axe to respond to the Doom like greediness, I think it's a decent idea, but I just, you know, it's a Matu doggy. Like, you have to go for the Matu doggy.
Okay, thank you to all three of our panelists. We'll hear from them at the end of the first game, but now let's go over to our commentary team. For this one, we have Gods and Capitalist.
You couldn't ask for a better match to close out day number 4 as you have the number 1 ranked team in the world, Team Liquid, facing up against crowd favorite Fnatic. Gods, who's going to be cheering at the end of this series?
I mean, we're going to know. If Fnatic come out on top, you'll hear it, but Liquid, a very tough opponent for them. This is the team people expected to kind of cruise through the winner bracket. They dropped down, but This is a tough series. It's a rematch from the group stage. It was a 2-1 series. Fnatic, they've kind of prepared something here, it looks like.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's head into game number one.
Fnatic versus Team Liquid.
So it is a signature Team Liquid overwhelming style of push from them facing up against Fnatic's choice of being able to get a lot of team fight. You've got a little bit of wombo combo there with the Darkseer and the Sven combined up with the Invoker, but it's the last pick, DJ's Axe, that is probably the most interesting linchpin of this lineup. Choosing to go from that greedy four position, we were talking about it before, it feels like a pretty decent pick. I'm just concerned that Liquid are just going to get, you know, just enough in the laning phase and start five-manning and taking objectives real early.
And Liquid have kind of put together a draft where Fnatic, they make a mistake come mid-game time, you lose a lot. You're going to lose towers, Roshan, objectives, and if you ever lose a fight near your base, that could just be a lane of rags. That's the beauty of this Lycan plus Death Prophet draft, is that you can play slightly from behind. All you're waiting for is that one big opening.
Yeah, if you want to talk about the philosophy of Liquid, it really seems that this team is definitely defined by their pressure on objectives. They're always looking to try and force fights on the enemy side of the base. That way they can turn one fight into an objective, or in a lineup like this, two or three objectives with so much pushing power behind them.
Yeah. And what we saw out of Fnatic yesterday against was newbie is that they sometimes are prone to those like late game decision-making faults, which is kind of what led to just a sudden loss in game number two, for example. But yeah. Fnatic, they've got to really step up their game here if they want to take down a draft like this from Liquid.
All right, so our lanes are going to be broken down here. We've got the Darkseer facing up against a Disruptor and Lycan at the top lane. Ohio already going to feel some pressure from Jerix. Meanwhile, in the mid lane, we've got mid-1's Invoker up against Fada's Death Prophet, and then Mind Control's the Slardar is sitting there in the bottom lane up against 343 and Mushi. So both offlaners going to feel some pressure, but should still be able to pick up a moderate amount of experience. Gods, how do you expect the mid lane to unfold?
For specifically the mid lane, mid-1 very good mechanically, but Fata, he's on a Death Prophet, Spirit Siphon, just one of those spells, which means you're never going to actually lose your lane against Invoker. So should be a bit of a farm trade. The big question is going to come from the rotations. So does someone like a Doom make an early smoke gank towards mid lane? If he can get like a useful creep, if he can find a nice 2-minute rune, there is potential for that Kuroki pressure on mid.
Yeah, while the similarities are there between our two offlaners, the starkest difference is going to be between our four positions. Axe is much more likely to spend his time full on trying to farm away, while Kuro, obviously on the Doom, is going to be trying to pressure the Axe and might just be able to find it here. DJ, he's left with only 75 HP. He's going to try and juke his way through the trees. Eats a tango. Kuro turns the wrong direction and might not be able to get him in time. Chases all the way right into the tier 3 area, but won't be able to pick up that kill, and may just have to suffice with just a pick up on that Hellbear. Now picks up his level 2, but DJ, he's already got the healing salve up. A man fight between the two, but mid-1, he's going to make it a 2-for-1. He never comes in. The sun strike over the top, and this could be our first blood as DJ cleaves through with his axe.
Great heads-up play from DJ to turn that around with the salve. And Kuro, biggest issue for him is that he found such a kind of worthless creep. He had the armor aura from the tornado creep, which doesn't really help that aggressive rotation. He was also level 1, so it's a very aggressive play from Kuro. He's mostly just trying to find some XP leads there, and in the end he gets overextend very much so.
Yeah, if only he had like maybe even a Seder Blast, could have been enough to finish off the Axe as soon as he found that hero, but very clearly a bit too greedy as he dives in too deep. Mid 1, able to punish that with the help of DJ. So that will obviously lean things a little bit more towards the favor of Invoker as he gets some of that experience. Fana still doing well for himself in the mid lane, and CS though, 14-3, well ahead of mid-1 at this point. It seems like he's really seeing the advantage he's got in his hands. He's pushing forward, sometimes past the creep wave, ready to threaten with that Spirit Siphon.
Does feel like Mushi not farming perhaps as well as he should be in this safe lane. He's a good 5 CS behind the Lycan, still early days, but this is just kind of unexpectedly well-played lane coming out from Mind Control. Normally Witch Doctor, one of those hard to play against heroes, but 343 not going for any points in the Maledict, which is often that zoning tool that we see out of Witch Doctors against Sladders and just Tidehunters, whatever tanky melee offlane is you may want to run. And as a result, Slider's got a lot out of this bottom lane.
Kuro looking for a chance at redemption here in the mid lane. Is going to try and rotate in with his Infernal Blade and now has a Shockwave from the Satyr he's eaten earlier. See whether or not it's successful. Wave is going to push into the tower. Kuro still not feeling comfortable with this position. He's going to bide his time. Meanwhile, the Axe at the top lane, he's going to be able to find a successful rotation. Jerix is the easy pickup with the Ion Shell as DJ mans forward. Now mid one is going to be gone on. The Cedar Blast is going to come through. Kuro picks up the kill there, so the trade-off not fully worth it for Fnatic as the Invoker definitely the much higher priority hero between the two.
Yeah, we're seeing early pressure from the Axe, much like the Doom, and I think this is Fnatic's way of trying to match the aggression coming out from Kuro's Doom by just getting DJ active and involved. But he needs to be careful, he's very low up top.
Yeah, he's going to be hit by this one. He's going to be blocked in by the kinetic field, and a couple of right clicks will finish him off. Ohio's going to come through, but won't be able to punish with that Ion Shell. So DJ, little bit too far forward there. Still able to finish off his Tranquil Boots, though, and that will help speed along his jungle. Kuro, similar story, though that's really just to help his roaming potential. As he speeds around the map, he's going to be spotted out by this ward, though.
Yeah, this Invoker start is going to be very worrying for Fnatic. The Doom pressure combined with just Fata completely destroying him in last hits. 26 CS to 11. Mid one's getting wrecked by Fata here. And
a big difference between the four positions. Again, DJ can't really pressure a Death Prophet like this, but he can continue to try and pressure this top lane. He's going in big time. The Sunstrike over the top. That'll finish off Jerix, giving mid one some much needed golden experience. And now they start cutting the creep wave. Matumba Man is fighting back against Ohio, but now he's going to have so much of his lane taken away from him if it starts pushing into the tower and he's forced to be dove by both these two tanky heroes of Fnatic.
I like this adjustment from mid one at mid. He's got a point in Wex, so he can go into Ghost Wall.
Mid one going to be caught again here. He's going to be hit by the Infernal Blade, slowed down. The Sunstrike right in front of the tier two. And Kuro, hit by that one, is taken out. Beautiful paralyzing cast from 343. Another Spirit Siphon will go down, and 343 may actually get taken out by Fata, who right clicks him towards the end. 4-3 now as they lose support for support in the mid lane, but they really wanted to be able to pick up that Invoker kill.
Beautiful rotation from 343 with the TP in, 2 points in the cast, locking them down. It looked like a scenario where mid one should have just gone into the Ghost Walk, but he knew the TP was coming. He had the infused raindrops to give him that extra bit of sustain, and the aggressive cold snap Sunstrike under a tower just destroyed Kuro TPing in, and that really helped mid one out.
DJ again locked in, but it's going to be a while until, oh, never mind. Matumba's already got his level 6, so he will be able to get here in time. DJ actually canceling his TP, and that just might cost him his life. He goes for the call, but Fata's going to meet him inside the river, finish him off immediately, taking off that Battle Hunter.
DJ, very aggressive play in this top lane. He's died twice now up here. He needs to be careful that he does maintain some sort of item progression, not just prioritize the pressure that he's trying to put on this lane. Lycan's been completely free farming away. Matumba Man's had no problem whatsoever dealing with this dual lane out of the Axe and Darkseer. So I think for DJ, it's time to perhaps settle down, farm up the Blink Dagger, and just prioritize creating space a bit less and just getting your own actual items going.
Yeah, it seems like he kind of feels like this pressure of like, oh, mid one, I can't really help him in the mid lane. The only thing I can do, right, is go for those side lanes and maybe set up Sunstrike kills. But that is clearly turning against Fnatic as Liquid are able to play defensively enough around it. And we've seen the way that, like, Axes can boost through the jungle so damn quickly. There is no real need for DJ to purely sit inside of the lanes, but he's going to try again here in the bottom lane, see if this is a bit more successful. They're going to catch Mind Control potentially, come out with a paralyzing cast. Will be able to follow this one up with a call. Mind Control hit by the Sunstrike, not quite, but still a Stormbolt will follow this up, and Witch Doctor's the one to pick up the last hit.
Sunstrike would have been the ideal scenario for that kill with mid one behind the Death Prophet, but still a kill on a very high level Slaughter. This Slaughter's managed to hit level 7 in the off lane. Hasn't really been pressured that much by the Fnatic dual lane, but Mushi starting to rack up a decent amount of farm, and once he gets that Helm of the Dominator going and starts stacking Ancients, that's where Liquid are going to have to constantly keep vision of that area and apply pressure to prevent Mushi getting out of control in terms of his farm.
Yeah, and this is why it's so important for them to be able to take that tier 1 tower in the offlane as quick as possible. You could already see Jerix and Matumba Man trying to go for these objectives, but will be repelled as both DJ and 343 going to come in. Immediate glimpse back from the Witch Doctor, only able to get off that paralyzing cast, but DJ alone can defend the tier 1. Oh god, Strength gonna be activated here. They're gonna go for mind control, see if it's going to be enough. Stun time, they already get off the Centaur stun, the follow-up Slithering Crush. And a nice save there from Kuro.
They didn't communicate. The cast was still on cooldown from top lane. They go in, and I think Mushi didn't quite realize that 343 didn't have a follow-up stun. If they have a caster, that's a very easy kill for them, but they weren't quite ready to go in, and mind control tanking up infused raindrops. We're seeing this item all across your core heroes, makes everyone just that little bit tankier in the early game, and does force out rotations bottom from Liquid, so it gives mid one a bit of room to grow in mid lane, but until he gets that Midas, he is going to be playing from behind the fastest Death Prophet.
Yeah, speaking of him, even though he had to rotate to the bottom lane due to some aggression from Fnatic, he's still keeping top of the net worth chart, and we'll be able to potentially see him rotate to a side lane just to be able to take an objective sometime soon. Most of the time, one of the big advantages of Death Prophet is a mid laner. He ever goes away, you can easily take that tier 1 mid, but in this case, the Invoker is pretty happy to just sit farming between the lane and the neutrals.
The most, I think, impressive part of that, about Kuro's early game plays, he's gotten these two very deep observer wards in the Fnatic jungle, and these spot out and scout a lot because they will be looking to start stacking these Ancients soon. The ward over by the Secret Shot reveals that, and they're spending a lot of time using the jungle camps near the mid lane, be it for the Invoker, the Axe, so Liquid can really keep tabs of the rotations out of Fnatic using these two wards, and it helps them find kills when they go for smoke plays like this.
Yeah, 10 minutes in, that top lane is decently pushed in, same goes for mid, so it could be that Liquid might be able to get the successful rotation out. Meanwhile, Fado's already going on to the Axe, will be able to catch DJ out, the right clicks are going to be enough, but back to bottom lane, Mushi going to be caught in the kinetic field, won't be able to escape from this gank it seems, and Liquid can easily turn this into plus one as 343, he's also going to go down as the amplified damage follows his movements all the way through the trees. And he has real hope of escape. The only thing he can hope to do is stall up Liquid's push into the tier 1 tower, but mid 1 may still end up going down. His spot is Exodus is not quite out yet, but he does manage to get the Ghost Walk at the last second.
Everything about that gank just so good. They put themselves in a position to get a tier 1
tower. Oh, he knows he only needs a few more seconds for the rest of Fnatic to be back, but now he's been doomed up. DJ's here, but can't get the call up in time, and now his ally's already dead. He's been glimpsed back to base.
You dive a tower like that and you've got a disruptor glimpse to back you up. You feel so safe knowing that that follow-up, that respawn from the Axe isn't going to be something that you can punish you. And Fnatic getting overrun at both bottom lane and even to some extent mid. Fata hasn't even had to go with his team. He gets a solo kill the Exorcism, zones mid one out from the middle lane. And you make that rotation bottom and find the kills. You have that guaranteed follow-up tier 1 tower. You're also not even trading it for a tier 1 mid. Mid 1 sees the 4 heroes bottom. It's like, okay, time to pressure mid. That's like the counterplay when your team gets smoking like that. But Fata's already there, still with Exorcism up, ready to defend it. Hitting level 11 now. Fata is just getting out of control.
Two-man smoke gank here from 343 and DJ. Matumba Man may be caught here. The Wolves trying to do some body blocking, and DJ, as soon as he sees that Slardar with the amplified damage, he immediately backs away, not wanting to take this man fight anymore.
Yeah, Fnatic are just going to have to slow things down a lot, play the kind of farm reactionary game, and that's something Liquid have the right tools to punish. They can fight very well around the Exorcism, they can take objectives, take Roshan, so if you're going to be avoiding Liquid, well, they'll be taking objectives.
One of the dangerous things is, again, the aggressive vision laid down by Liquid. It's going to be scouting out a lot of what Fnatic are going to be doing in the jungle. Now, Fnatic do have the right defensive wards around their Radiant jungle to try and protect it, but still, losing that tier 1 is going to make it a bit difficult to stop these invasions, as once again you're going to see Jerix pop on through here and try and see if he can catch somebody out, goes for a counter ward, making sure that Fnatic don't have vision here, but either way, not going to be the case.
Fnatic still looking for their level 6 on Witch Doctor. They're struggling across the board right now as DJ works towards his Blink Dagger. It just feels like everything on Fnatic's side is just being delayed a bit. The Helm of the Dominator timing for Sven. Normally you see Sven having farmed his first Ancient stacks by around the kind of 10 to 12 minute mark, and Mushi, he's got it there, he can go for it soon, but it's very dangerous to do so because of how poorly the laning stage has gone. They kind of have to recognize that if Liquid come in, win a fight with the Exorcism, they can actually clean up and steal those Ancients with Exorcism, with Lycan, the sustain that he provides. Very risky for Fnatic to look to take that Ancient stack or even really take any kind of a fight until they finish off the Blink Dagger at bare minimum on DJ.
Nice play there from 343, finding one of the aggressive wards just laid out by Jarek. If you were in Fnatic's position, which would you rather see here? Would you rather see them try and protect that Radiant jungle, or would you rather see them go offensive and maybe invade the Dire jungle and go for a tier 1 themselves?
Going for the tier 1 top is really something they can only do as a trade. I think they have to react a lot to what Liquid are doing, which is going to be taking back control of your own jungle through dewarding. You can see they've already put down two sentries. There's still one ward left there, but you want to deny vision from Liquid to kind of regain control over your own jungle and make it harder for Liquid to keep finding these kills, to keep finding these objectives.
Well, might be that a pickoff from this fresh Blink Dagger of DJ could actually lead Fnatic into taking some control of their own destiny. Three-man smoke gank. They're going to go for the double ion shell blink initiation. See if they can just blow up one and perhaps turn this into a tier one mid push as well. The Liquid are already rotating two supports behind Fada, but it may not matter. First damage is easily going to overwhelm Fada. Jarex, he was quick on the static storm, but it doesn't matter. Four heroes take out Fada and will now push into the mid tier one.
Yeah, they did not mess around. The Meteor and the Death Ward committed for that, but with good reason. That is such an important kill for them to be getting. It may not secure them this tier 1 tower with Liquid having heroes there, but Static Storm down and still 25 seconds without Death Prophet.
Yeah, this
will be the tier 1 both top and mid.
Yeah, this is perfect. We saw Liquid do a similar thing about 5 minutes ago, but Fnatic able to respond now at the 15-minute mark by being able to push down both tier 1 towers. Attempt at the deny, nice. Not quite good enough. Mid 1 jukes them out there. And will secure the last hit with a lowly Fork Spirit.
I mean, all it took was one smoke gank with the Axe Blink on a Death Prophet to turn this game around. It gets them two towers and a kill, and that early game advantage from Liquid has been entirely negated off of that. This is one of the perhaps biggest weaknesses with the Liquid draft. I like their draft, don't get me wrong, but they don't have that defensive save hero. When you're running a Death Prophet, often you see this paired up with like a Dazzle, even Oracles, Tusk.
Ventral Spirit, yeah.
Yeah, this is a big reason why the Tusk was banned, but not the Earth Spirit. I mean, I guess by that point you didn't know a Death Prophet was in the pool, but having a defensive save hero when you've got a Death Prophet on your team or you've got a high-value mid player like Fata is so important, and there's nothing to actually save or protect Fata.
Ohio. Oh, don't tell me he's going to be able to get away from that one. Nice. Very unlucky there from Liquid as they smoke through and get popped on Ohio is holding hard right side. Wasn't with, even in the side shop.
With them revealing bottom, this means Mushi knows it's safe for him to farm the Ancient Stack. Oh, getting away with this uncontested.
And that healthy jump up in gold. As he cleaves through the Ancients, Liquid are still going to try and take an objective here. They immediately start going for Roshan. Fnatic, we're hearing a lot of cheers right now, but they may not know exactly why. They're pushing in both mid and the top lane at the same time. They may even know about this, Roshan, yeah. And try and just say, okay, it's better for us to trade off at this point, since Liquid are hitting a decent peak with Fada being so large on that level 2 Exorcism.
After the Darkseid TP out from bottom, they just didn't have the map vision around that area. They took the two towers, which gave them access to the Dire Jungle. Now that they've won that one fight, this is a stage where it's like, okay, we took two towers, we found our pickup, we hit our item times, now we want to take over the enemy jungle. We've gone through and weathered the storm of the Liquid early game, and Fnatic's draft matches up incredibly well. The burst damage from both Sven as well as Invoker is amazing against Death Prophet. You kind of have to go BKB against Invoker, but then you've got the Mushi physical damage to tear through the BKB.
And Liquid almost too slow. They do have the Glyph actually stalling things up enough that they will be able to get the potential initiation. Mind Control leading the way here, but look at Mushi. He's looking to be able to make a Quelling Blade initiation perhaps. Mid one is going to be caught, glimpsed back to the Static Storm, and Mushi realizes, no. Can't fight that one. Everyone else of Fnatic will be able to escape. DJ just on the skin of his very teeth. Mind Control just a half a second too late with a Slithering Crush.
Yeah, nice catch from Liquid. This is why Disruptor has just been so influential throughout this main event and why it has been such a high priority support pick. It forces a fight and it means once you engage, you can't just get out.
Jump in on Ohio. Looks like they're still hoping to be able to get a glimpse play here with the Amplified damage, but he's not close enough. And either way, that pick off in the top lane is good for Liquid, but at least Fnatic are getting something out of it. Immediately, they had DJ pushing out the bottom lane. He's going to force someone from Liquid to defend that tier one. And they're actually getting, that's an impressive thing. Liquid is a team that prioritizes map control, prioritizes pushing out waves to be able to get information, but it's actually Fnatic who have been holding more of that control than Liquid. I mean,
so much goes back to that initial Axe pickoff mid. Up until that point, Liquid had complete map control of the Dire Ancients, of the entire, the Radiant Ancients, as well as the entire Radiant jungle, and that vision has been lost since Liquid had been put on the back foot. Sure, you take an Aegis, but I think in terms of the big picture, you've lost complete map control. You're getting out farmed now to some extent, and the way this game's going to progress is going to look very good for Fnatic. Sven, in a game like this against multiple melee cores, a Doom is just gonna shine.
Yeah, certainly. Even this like one little play, you saw three heroes up here in the top lane, like Mushi's just taking away the Dire jungle, purely farming that, doesn't even show himself in the top lane. Lets it push forward because he knows Liquid are so scared. They're just sitting around the mid lane constantly because they have such good aggressive vision from Fnatic. They know they can play a game like this where they just sit pretty defensively, farm up much more efficiently at this point than Liquid are, or have been, for the last 3 or 4 minutes.
And that's part of the beauty of this early blink pickup from Mushi. Doesn't go straight into the BKB or even the SMY, just has a farming Yasha, and he knows that the threat of his blink initiation with God's Ring is brutal.
Yeah, you can see the blink initiation from DJ here, as Matumba Man's gonna get popped just like that. There goes the Aegis, but still, they do have the glimpse back. DJ gonna be pulled back into play, as Mind Control should be able to finish pop. Matumba Man now pops open for the vacuum into the Meteor Blast, and that pops Kuro. He gets taken out. Matumba Man trying to challenge, but he's gonna get popped with the paralyzing cast. Good Slithering Crush, and actually allows Matumba Man to be able to make the escape away. Ohio has been doomed up. Fauna's right in the middle of everyone saying, hit me! He's got all the exorcism damage to be able to take out Fnatic one by one. And they're gonna look for a little bit more. Midwan does manage to get off his ghost walk in time. Paul back into the counter, gets off the old scepter, but now it's gonna be Liquid surrounding him, able to take him out. That's gonna be a full wipe as Liquid take control back by forcing the ultimate team fight in mid.
Yeah, Mushi goes in from the high ground with God Strength, but they needed to prioritize killing Fatamor. As soon as he blinked in, he got thrown up in the air by a Fata Yules. It was fantastic Death Prophet play out of Fata. And without the burst damage onto the Death Prophet, I mean, Fata just reigns supreme. They didn't have the tools to deal with him, and at that point, they just kind of overcommitted. The Fnatic's view on that fight is like, okay, we get a free pickoff on the Aegis, but it's never a free pickoff when you're versing Disruptor. Once you're committed, you're going to get caught. You're going to get pulled back in by the glimpse, and at that point, Liquid had all the tools to punish Fnatic's aggression.
It seems Fnatic, who earlier in the tournament we saw in series, them prioritizing Disruptor first, and maybe we're seeing them actually getting a taste of their own medicine here in this matchup against Liquid. 7-14, 21 minutes in. Our metrics still looking okay for Fnatic. It hasn't gotten too far out of control with about 2 or 3K lead for Liquid, but nothing that can't be overcome, especially with this ancient stacking. As you can see, again, Mushi takes the time. Clear out one of those wolves while finishing up that ancient stack.
He's going to complete the SMY. Still a very important game for him to get a BKB, I feel. Just so you don't get Yulzed up in the air, Infernal Blades, Disruptor, Slaughter Crushes. There's so much like control on the side of Liquid. Even things like Necrobooks burning your mana pool can be very annoying to deal with. And you want to be able to kill off that Necrobook, so you need to have the magic community.
But yeah, we talked about the fact that Fada doesn't have a saving hero, and this means he has all the more incentive to sit way far in the back, which means you can't rely on Fnatic's other heroes like DJ Zax to make a clean initiation where the Sven's able to go in uninterrupted. Midwan gets popped just like that. DJ hoping to be able to save him, can't quite get there in time, and now he's going to be caught, it looks like, as Matumba Man continues to go for the kill with just the Necronomicons, and will get the Doom onto Mushi, so no counter initiation there, but Ohio managed to get off the mech. Everyone from Fnatic looking over. Okay, but now the Slithering Crush comes on to DJ. Ohio does manage to get past the tier 2 tower, but DJ is going to be the one pursued out. Paralyzing Cask will slow down Liquid enough, it seems, that they are going to be forced back. Still no response from Fnatic, and that all comes down to Kuro getting the Doom off on Mushi, made sure that there was no potential from any kind of counter-offensive play from Fnatic in that fight.
Yeah, Liquid are so close to getting multiple follow-up kills there with the Glimpse. They just couldn't quite burst anyone down. The Axe tanky enough to survive through it all. DJ now with a completed Vanguard, so good news for Fnatic is it's just the one loss on mid-1's Invoker, but we're seeing Anytime he gets jumped, he just gets completely torn apart. He has no real defensive capabilities. He's still very underfarmed and squishy at this stage of the game.
We are still looking at two heroes that, if you want to look at just purely the objective of these two teams, right, you're looking at an Axe as well as an Invoker who has a Midas. Those are pretty farm-heavy heroes that are just going to get stronger as they go into the mid-game. While Liquid, it's not to say that they're going to stall out by any means, but they have reached a certain kind of peak with that Necrobook 3 and building into the AC on Matumba Man. They want to be able to take these Tier 2s out of commission from Fnatic and haven't been able to just yet.
Yeah, like a not really hero known to scale well past the mid game. He's very much a, we've got Aegis, we've taken all the outer towers, now let's push high ground and win the game by 30, 40 minutes. So if Fnatic can weather the storm and trade evenly during this stage of the game, their late game's looking much stronger. You've got the Invoker, the Sven. Even a hero like Darkseid, who's so good at defending high ground, he'll scale well into the late game because this Lycan AC, you hit him with a wall, you're stealing these auras. You've got a free Assault Crest for your team. So having a Darkseid means that Fnatic are just going to get better and better throughout this game. But it's that possible punish that can come from Liquid. You lose one fight, you've lost your high ground. So right. Fnatic have to play flawlessly to get to that late game stage.
Yeah. These next 10 minutes are going to be of particular importance to Fnatic. They've done well for the first 20 to 25 to hold this game close, but we've reached that danger territory. Liquid are going to go from taking objectives. They even have another Roshan coming up soon. We'll see whether or not Fnatic are going to go for the split push play or try and contest in the next few minutes. Right now, they are doing a nice job pushing out that top lane as well as mid, forcing Liquid back, unable to take the tier two at the bottom lane. So Fnatic, just a small like tactical play there of being able to stop a push before it even happens from Liquid by pushing out the side lanes.
Chasing up top, mind control initiation. Gonna catch 343, just a Witch Doctor if they want to just abandon him. It looks like that may be the call.
Paralyzing Cast, gonna TP out. 343 does get, he's got the Amplify damage on him, so an easy glimpse for Jerix. But I think that was very important. The discipline there from Fnatic to not try and jump that, to not try and save the Witch Doctor. Just give him up in a play like that. A pickoff doesn't mean much, especially like a Witch Doctor. Liquid need a whole lot more if they want to be able to take control of this game.
Yeah. It was kind of funny because it looked like Liquid were almost unsure of themselves. Like, do we really want to go for this? They stopped hitting the Witch Doctor because they were suddenly like, wait, is this five Fnatic heroes? Liquid didn't have their whole team up there.
Oh, Mushi. Mushi blink over to the side. He's actually going to go for Jerix. They will be able to pop him immediately. Ohio throws out the vacuum wall. Now they're both going to try and escape with ult used. Mushi. Still got the Blink Dagger and will be able to TP out, but it's Ohio who's going to be caught there, unable to get his TP off. He does have the Blink Dagger up in a second and will be able to make the escape. Mind Control and Hot Pursuit, though, does have a Force Staff as well as a Blink himself. Will be able to catch him again off the Slithering Crush. They've got the Infernal Blade as well, and Ohio knows it. He's done for, so he throws the Ion Shell onto the creep. But look at what Fnatic are doing. They immediately start pushing out the mid. Midwan does what he can and then Ghost walks himself away. Liquid may need some dust or some gems if they hope to be able to. Oh, Necrobooks.
Not going to find mid one who's made all the way to the top lane, so.
They do need to try and punish this Invoker at least once for a play like that. Make him a little bit more scared.
Liquid aren't quite keeping these lanes pushed out. Constantly we're seeing, like, be it mid one or Mushi just split pushing lanes. Liquid getting very close to finding these key pickoffs. Yeah. Finding out with Darkseer there isn't really the ideal outcome for Liquid. They want to get that Mushi Sven. He just happened to, almost by sheer luck, blink away from Slada's initiation because he was going on Jerix, but Fnatic getting farm out of the map, pressuring the tier 2 mid, and the Darkseid for Disruptor exchange is actually kind of favorable for Fnatic just because they got so much elsewhere on the map while it was happening.
Right. There's the BKB that you wanted to see from Mushi. We also have a Crimson Guard on DJs. Those are pretty big pickups, actually. The damage reduction, really helpful against him, this minus armor, as well as a lot of the summons that Lycan's going to be thrown around between the wolves and the Necrobook. And I like their choice to group up at this point in time. They can contest Liquid in a team fight, and it's right around Roshan being up as well. So this actually coincides rather well. Fnatic hitting a timing that is perfect if they can get the right kind of initiation in this next one. And unfortunately, they are being scattered out. Liquid are setting up here. by Five Man Smoking through the lane, wrapping through. Fnatic know what's going on, though. They're going to run into 3-4-3. That's our free kickoff. Let's see what Fnatic do from here. They're actually going to start retreating out. 3-4-3, definitely dead. Fnatic, he do about to go. That pull. Static Storm over the top of Tumba Man. Almost immediately goes down, but mid one, Cop of the Doom. Now gets hit by the Slithering Crunch. There's the trade up, but Mushi still going forward. Ion Shell plus the BKB. Knows he can't fight this, though. Has to leave DJ behind as Liquid take four and will be able to now push forward into the tier two.
Yeah, they focus everything on the Lycan, which is like, okay, but I think the bigger threat is still Fastest Death Prophet, who stays alive the entire fight. They don't get the Lycan AC aura as well with the Darkseid Wall at the start. And as a result, it's going to be Fnatic who have to back off, give up Roshan, and trade a Lycan for four heroes, not the ideal outcome for them.
And this is where the game really starts going the way of Liquid. We talked about how this 25 to 35 minute mark is going to be where Fnatic need to be the most careful in taking these team fights. Otherwise, one bad team fight leads into Liquid getting aggressive wards, starts taking some tier twos, and goes from there. Now we see this Aegis should be able to allow Liquid to bully Fnatic even more once their ultimates are up.
He needs to, farms any more camps here.
He'll be pulled back, blink away, and still going to be caught by this kinetic field and actually hit by the Slithering Crush. Now, Mushi is still very, very tanky and has his BKB ready to go, but it may be a bit too late as now Kuro comes in. Sunstrike is actually going to turn this fight around and kills Mind Control. Now, Mushi, all he has to do is actually get the escape. Kuro desperate to be able to stop this Blink Dagger. One more second, almost there. DJ with the interference, but still the glimpse back on Mushi will make sure he dies. Now, they have a Meteor over the top, will be able to catch, but Tumba Man can't get the Culling Blade, but it's still enough to make it a trade-off. The Sven for the Lycan. And they also got Mind Control Slardar as well. That was a beautiful piece of work there from Fnatic. Nice rotations to be able to at least make that a lot more closer than it should have been.
I mean, that end of the day is a great trade for Fnatic, even though it was not the intent from Mushi getting caught out in the jungle. They turned a bad situation into a much better one.
They're looking for more. They know they have that numbers advantage. Fnatic are trying to push it. They've got the tier 2 at mid that was low, but Vada managed to pick up the Tenai. They start blinking themselves forward, looking for any hero they can. Not going to catch Liquid with their pants down, though.
I really like the Solar Crest pickup on Kuro's Doom, getting items to help fight the Sven and help protect the Fata Death Prophet or even the Lycan. Whoever gets initiated by the Sven is likely just going to melt because you don't have any real reliable BKB piercing disable, so having the Solar Crest will just help that one hero tank up a lot.
Speaking of our Sven, I really like the way that we're seeing Mushi really focus on pressing this to a late game build. Normally we'd see like maybe an Echo Saber into consideration or something like that, but not him. He went for the early Blink Dagger, which applied the pressure that you were talking about earlier, which allowed Fnatic to keep themselves spread. And then from that SNY, he's now focusing on the late game items. He's going to go for that Daedalus. He's going to pick up maybe that Satanic or something, something that allows him to tank through a little bit more. And he will be one of the hardest carries that we'll have in this game.
Oh yeah, and I don't really feel like there's an easy way for Lycan to itemize such that he can fight Mushi well in the lane. He can get a lot of armor, of course, but being able to actually deal damage through the Warcry, Sven is just, his DPS far exceeds the Lycan once you get to that 40-50 minute stage of the game. And perhaps we see something like an Abyssal Blade build out of Matumba Man to give him some control as well as a bit of extra sustain, but Sven is just going to be king of the late game.
He's just got a hope to challenge, I think, everybody but the Sven. Liquid are going to have to kite Mushi around as much as possible, but that's going to be dangerous because it's not just a single core Sven who's going to be carrying this game for Fnatic. They also have mid one who's level 16 with completed Ags. We're getting very close to having that AoE Deafening Blast that makes all the difference in these team fights, but Fnatic, they're actually going to have a very aggressive ward laid out. Their smoke is going to get popped, and Liquid have all the information they need, but Fnatic may still find the initiation. Mid one, jump in. Fnatic going to be able to find that Yule Scepter initiation onto DJ. Follow up, Mind Control jumps on a 3-4-3, but Liquid hesitant to jump in past this tier 2 tower.
They have to be diving into Darkseer, perhaps one of the biggest traps they could fall into right now.
Yeah.
If they want to try initiate and get a kill, they've got to do it with just one or two heroes. They can't commit 3-4 heroes into a fight until they've got the Darkseer doomed or something.
Particularly since this Aegis isn't all too important for Liquid. If they use that exorcism on the first life,
You end up getting popped as a Death Prophet. Second life isn't going to mean much for you. Liquid are hoping that they're going to be able to catch someone out going for the typical ward or counter ward play near that cliff area. But Fnatic, not going to be foolish enough to try that. They're just going to give up their tier 2 and give up their vision in exchange for keeping this
game. Fnatic here. This is perhaps a very risky place for Fnatic to go farming.
They're going to try and push out into the dire jungle. Liquid.
He should know there's a gem because Jarek's just dewarded around that mid lane.
Maybe he can just straight out outrun it though. Jarek may actually show himself in mid. Mushi is kind of being surrounded right now by so many heroes on the map. Still,
with a Sunstrike, he can get killed.
Yeah, he can, but mid one may not have the time for that Sunstrike as he's going to be silenced up. Oh, Yule Scepter goes down right as the silence does. Mid one may still be able to make the escape. Another Yule Scepter, this time from Fada, slowing down mid one's retreat, but he managed to get off the Ghost Watch. Now he gets away. Fada going to be jumped on by Mushi. The physical damage is cleaving through, but they can't quite get the hold long enough, and Spirit Siphon is doing its work. Now the rest of Liquid come in from behind as Mushi's BKB has run out. The Centaur stun misses. And that means Mushi will be able to get away, but the rest of Fnatic cannot. That's going to be mid one as well as the Axe falling. And tier one and tier two, I believe, are now forfeit. Liquid will take all the outer towers of Fnatic.
DJ misses the call on the Death Prophet when he initiates there because that was the big kill they needed. The Aegis is actually gone now, but they killed Fata's Death Prophet and Exism is down. Fnatic can take that fight, but missing the call meant that Mushi could not reliably deal damage to him. And Fnatic now down two, and this is the classic Liquid play. They win one fight near your base, and suddenly they're going to be in a position to break high ground.
35 minutes in, that danger zone has come to a peak now. As Liquid force a buyback out of mid one, that hurts. That's going to stall out that refresher, which is kind of like the be-all, end-all of team fight items for the Invoker. So Liquid have successfully stalled that one up, gotten a huge fall of gold for themselves as they now are 5k ahead, 5k experience as well. And they're feeling comfortable. They can even sit back, play some more farming games, and wait for the next Roshan, which will be Aegis and Cheese if they really want to. I would say they've kind of eased up the pressure of late game a bit with that play.
Yeah, they're going to just be a lot more comfortable knowing that they can hit that next item timing. They're going to have a BKB on the Tumberman. They'll have the Octarine Core on Death Prophet, so they get that lower cooldown in Exism, which means there's less room for Fnatic to play around that cooldown.
Mm-hmm.
And off of the next Roshan with Aegis and Cheese, they're going to be looking for another fight like that near the Fnatic base. You win a fight, you get that pick off on someone like an Invoker or a Sven at the start, and then suddenly you're breaking high ground.
Even some of the utility items were lovely pickups. I love Mind Control, for example, getting the Force Staff and the Slardar. That was awesome. Jarek has one of his own, and he could even go something like a Ghost Scepter if he feels like he's going to be the one targeted in the next 20 gold. Other than that, Liquid seemed to be spread out, not really fearing that Fnatic are going to push into them, at least not for now. Fnatic do seem a bit scared. Grouping like up around that top.
And all these four staffs are pretty much to save Fata in a lot of ways. Like, if he gets jumped on by an Axe with a Sven follow-up, he needs to have some way to help him disengage the Sven, and that's the four staffs from Slaughter and, more importantly, the Disruptor, the tools to do that.
So Fnatic, they push out the top lane a decent amount, but Liquid not really caring about it. They are going to stay in this mid lane, keeping both mid and bottom pushed out. It means they have all the map control in the world because Fnatic are scared to actually head up to that top lane. But somebody still needs to protect that tier 3 tower eventually, unless they're going to let it just take some chip damage from the wave. And there it is, TP back from the Slardar. I like that choice just because that's one of the great things about Slardar, right? He can push out the wave. Okay, doesn't have the greatest wave clear with just Slithering Crush, but at least he's super mobile. So if there is going to be a push out from Fnatic, Slardar can still respond in probably about 5 to 10 seconds.
He's already sprinting back towards the Roshan pit area, it looks like, recognizing that Fnatic have been missing for a long time from the map. You have two wards right outside the Fnatic base, which means they're either sitting in their base as five doing nothing, which is obviously not the play. Well, now the Wolf actually scouts them out, or they're making a move with smoke out and being aggressive. So Liquid already in position to take a fight as five again.
Yeah, and you don't really care if that top lane is pushed out. Now you've stopped the momentum, and oh, Fada, this is a dangerous position. He's actually going to be spotted out. Pops BKB. DJ misses the call, and now stuck inside the trees. The Shivas goes out. BKB's on both sides wasted. And now, whoa, blink for blink. Mind Control. One step ahead of Mushi, Matumba Man's gonna pop his ultimate. He wants to take this one, he's gonna be doomed up, glimpse back straight to the Static Storm, and that is a very dead carry from Fnatic. The rest of them trying to retreat. Matumba Man and Mind Control, speedy demons they are, but will not be able to find Fnatic in time to get another kill.
Yeah, Mushi just completely misreads the situation. The aggressive blink in after he'd already committed his BKB seemed completely unnecessary. It felt like, okay, you've just wasted Godstrength BKB on Sven. Well, Godstrength was still up. You don't have to fight mid lane, though.
Oh, my goodness. That's they're trying to make it play, and they've got it, too. Matumba Man is dead, and Jerix, having already used the glimpse, not going to be able to catch more. In fact, Fnatic, they actually think they could just go for this one. Force Staff over the cliff, calls for another Force Staff from Mind Control, gets it too. Stays away from DJ, who's now Static Stormed up. Going to be hit by Kuro by the Centaur stun, held in by the kinetic field. DJ just trying to save his own life at this point in time. Might be able to get more as they get the vacuum between the two. They're paralyzing cask, holding them in place. Sunstrike, not quite enough. Jerix going to be hit by one more paralyzing cask, but will be able to get the glimpse back on DJ to execute him. And 3-4-3 is up next. Tornado hits at the right time, right as BKB falls, and they do manage to hold against Liquid and prevent that being too many pickoffs. And acts for the Lycan of Matumba Man. That is an okay trade-off there from Fnatic, but it would have been all the better if they just backed away after that kill.
Yeah, they got a bit greedy chasing for more, and then the four staffs kick into play as Liquid get away from the Axe, who was hunting for follow-up kills. Top lane Mind Control does not have his BKB.
Yeah, he's got to be careful here. Cold Snap, Forge Spirits dealing a lot of damage here. He's actually low enough that he gets a little bit more with the Tornado and perhaps a Sunstrike or a Meteor. No, mid one. He's actually scared. He doesn't put enough priority in that kill to risk his own life. So he just goes, walks, and gets the hell out of there. He will have a BKB soon. So in another scenario like that, though, and he can make the full-on initiation and still be able to TP away, Liquid have very little to be able to stop that.
Things settle down a bit here as we'll see what Liquid's next big move is going to be. They are in the Roche pit already, and Fnatic have their whole team alive and the smoke at play. Darkseer, if he can get in there for a vacuum wall in time, could turn this fight in Fnatic's favor, but Roche will drop very fast.
Yeah, and one of the hard parts is Liquid's team, with that amp damage, they can actually take up just two heroes inside the pit. So it doesn't even mean you have a positional advantage if you choose to fight into that Roshan area. If anything, it could be Liquid, especially Fnatic there up on the top side, able to come down as soon as the initiation comes in from Fnatic.
And I like the way Liquid used their scan there, just to protect themselves from the smoke initiation to the Roshan pit. And I think saving scans for moments like in the late game where you're going to go for a Roche is very, very important.
Now Liquid, they just have to deal with this pesky top push that is going to be coming more and more frequently now that we have that Boots of Travel from mid one, and he knows how important it is too. He hasn't been punished from one of these split pushes just yet, and he's going to continue to try and keep Liquid with one eye to the top lane.
Seeing an unconventional Doom item pick up, the Aghanim Scepter coming out for Kuro. I think recognizing that often the Doom target is not someone that's being focused down. They're Dooming a Sven just to take him out of the fight, prevent follow-up war cries, prevent him from being able to blink around.
Right.
Here come Fnatic, though. Smoking up, looking to engage.
Smoke across, DJ. This is an important initiation. We'll be able to get it to the Sunstrike over the top. We'll be able to blow up Mind Control. They can just get a little bit more physical damage, but it's not quite enough. Maybe Sven, he comes forward, goes straight for Mushi. They actually pass off, and we'll be able to help the Sven with the cheese. He gets a stun onto Mushi, and they start targeting him down with the amplified damage. But Axe, he gets the call onto both of them. Here comes the cleave damage, but will it be enough? The amp damage is too much, actually. Now Fada, he's cleaned up some of the heroes in the back and will be able to join the rest of his team to make sure DJ stays down three up from Fnatic. And that is going to be only for Disruptor and a cheese used. Mid one, he tries a little play there with a Sunstrike, but I know he's feeling desperate.
This Exorcism, this is danger time with Aegis, Exorcism. Matumba Man can just go in the front lines. We'll have another shapeshift soon. Very difficult to defend.
EMP just lead things off. Yule Scepter will be used by Fnatic to dodge that one. And you may see this whole entire bottom lane of Rax just being taken out of the vacuum. Into the Stormbolt, not going to be fast enough. The BKB is used first. And now they turn and try and take out mid one. He's forced the Yule Scepter onto himself. Unlikely to be able to get away. The amp damage and the physical damage too much combined. And yes, indeed, Liquid will take that first lane of Rax at bottom. And because Minwan died, they may even look for a little bit more, but that would be greedy. And you could already see they're not even sticking around for that Rain Tracks necessarily. It will be taken out by Cardi. Oh, not quite. They get the Stormbolt just in time, but still. The important ranks, the melee ranks, has been taken out. And Fnatic feeling a little bit more worse for wear as they will continue to feel all the pressure of Liquid. They're not going to give them any free map control whatsoever, it seems. Yeah.
These fights just seem to be coming down to the initiation from Fnatic not getting that insta-kill. But go bottom.
Stun.
Mind control.
Mind control pops his BKB, turns around, gets the Amplify damage onto Mushi, which has been one of the biggest problematic spells for him, is he can't actually challenge the Lycan very well. Pearl comes in, throws down that Purge. Will be enough for the Glimpse to be here. And 3-4-3, very likely to get taken out. Looks like the Wolf Stormbolt. Actually, right after the Stormbolt, you have to jump in. DJ managed to counter Mind Control, but it may not be enough. There's the vacuum pulled right back into the wall. Matumba Man going to have to just take a ranged Rex and runs himself back through mid. A lot of things being used there. Looks like they still managed to get the Witch Doctor thanks to the extra movement speed and the rundown, but they're not able to go for the second lane of Rex. So even they just got a support hero. They blew an ultimate or two, but it's the important one of Fadas. It's going to be a big one, but he's going to be taken out almost immediately. Comboed from Fnatic, and now they're going to be able to get so much more as they vacuum back, chasing Kuro with the cold snap, choosing against it though, mid one. You think he wanted to go, but he was just a little bit scared that Liquid would turn and they'd lose that fight.
Surprised he doesn't chase it. The BKB was wearing off, but that was kind of time to find some kills. You've just blown up a death problem. That's the combo it feels like Fnatic be missing. They're getting the jump like a few times, like in their own jungle early, where they get the Blink initiation onto Slaughter, but the follow-up damage has just never quite been there with either Mushi or in that situation, mid one, to burst down that first hero at the start of a fight. Last time, Slaughter gets off the cheese. This time around, Death Prophet blown up from full HP. That's exactly how Fnatic need to approach these engagements.
One of the hard things is it does seem the BKB defeats a lot of the initiation damage from Fnatic, so it almost seems like they have to try and force an initiation outside of the base, make Liquid blow those BKBs, and then try and extricate themselves from that team fight safely. But that just seems so unlikely because we've got the ever-present support of Jerix always being able to make sure you can't escape for free as long as he's got that line of sight. So Fnatic are actually going to be the ones pushing forward here. They've got 15 seconds to get damage on that tier 3 before Liquid are full power again.
Importantly, Aegis expires if Fnatic do want to take a fight and push, but with bottom lane coming in, I think they probably look back at their base and realize we've got to push this out. Lycan or even the Death Prophet with the boots of travel could just go for the backdoor play and take our mid lane of Rax with no glyph up. So respecting Liquid's push potential, and Fnatic will have to slow things down here, wait for their next opening.
Unfortunately, the progression of items just will not be there for Fnatic. It seems fast enough for this next team fight. I say that actually BKB being bought out by DJ. Does this mean he's giving up his buyback, potentially, for the next team fight?
I imagine for Fnatic, it's like you've got to just win that fight off of your initiation, because if it's a long, drawn-out fight where you're relying on buybacks, chances are you're losing your base while that happens. You've got to Lycan with Necrobook, a Death Prophet, Exorcism. Buyback isn't going to cut it to keep your racks alive.
True, and the BKB is one of those items that, you know, it's such a strong defensive item, it may be worth more having that rather than having two lives in a fight anyway. That being said, doesn't look like Midwan's going to get his refresher unless Liquid really slow this game down and don't push in for another 5 minutes. Sven has 3.7 on him. You may see another commitment by him into, I don't know, what would you commit for the Satanic at this point if you actually can get enough gold instead of having buyback? Or do you want to hold on to buyback? Do you want to see a different item entirely?
His buyback in 2 minutes. The other consideration for me is the Moon Shard, but
yeah.
You'd just be eating it. You haven't really got the item slots for it, so I think with Mushi, there's most likely buyback number one, and then when he can afford buyback with Satanic, you play around that. He's the one hero who I think having buyback probably matters a lot more on than your initiating heroes like Darkseer and Axe doesn't quite matter as much.
Unfortunately, they don't have the other armor item either. They've got the Shivas on Darkseer, but they're still missing an AC. And that would certainly help out a lot.
This guy's still the Lycans, you know?
Yeah, that's true, Yeah.
I watched it last time. The Lycan illusion just died like to one Crypt Swarm, though. Like, they got the Lycan illusion off the wall, but didn't actually stay alive. It's something worth microing just because it is a free AC aura.
Fnatic will be playing purely on the high ground, it seems, waiting for Liquid to take the first step here to progress this game one way or another. It's been a very tight game number one. Few mistakes by both sides, as Fnatic have had just a couple of misplays, such as Mushi's blink in at the bottom lane. But other than that, I would say it's been a pretty good game by them, holding their own against Liquid. We'll see whether or not they can continue to do so for the next 10 minutes, as Liquid may just be able to close out this game. They're waiting for the right kind of initiation, though. They're not trying to just pull up five men through the mid lane, as we have talked about the danger of that Darkseer with the wall. Mushi is going to be jumped on. There goes the Doom. They managed to purge him as well. No BKB save from him, and that'll be a long one with Kuro keeping his vision on him, but still DJ managed to get the counter initiation. Three BKB, three brawlers running through and just eviscerating the poor Witch Doctor, and they're going to find even more. Mid one, forced to pop his BKB, tries to get out. Good deafening blast to buy him space, but will it be enough? The Yule Scepter onto mind control. They have the vision, trying to keep up, but Mushi ends up going down. 100 seconds on the clock for him, and that could just be the end of it. Liquid finally get the kill.
His buyback will come off cooldown, so he does have one last hurrah here.
They have the exorcism. Jerix, he sends one back, trying to get DJ, preventing him from making his blink dagger initiation. A second lane of racks about to fall, but Liquid off the buyback of the Sven will retreat, and Fnatic will not be able to have any catch that prevents Liquid from escaping for free.
And Mushi just kind of off in no man's land again, very similar to what happened at bottom lane with the blink in. He's just a bit split apart from his own team, just trying to get some farm. He's not even pushing a lane out, and that's where I don't like that he's there trying to farm the Ancients, because you're not really helping your team strategically. He's just trying to get some item progression going for him, but he had plenty of farm and economy already, so completely unnecessary situation that he puts his team in, and this game gets a whole lot harder for Fnatic now that they don't have Mushi's buyback for the next 5 minutes.
Yeah, certainly. Liquid could even wait until, yeah, Roshan up 20 seconds. So this is perfect for them. They can get Aegis, they can get Cheese, siege the high ground, knowing that one kill on Sven is all it takes to end this game. And it's going to be all the pressure on Fnatic to somehow find an opening and be able to win a team fight that's stacked against them just to be able to stay alive in this game number one.
Good one. Lincoln Sphere over the refresher. I'm not sure how much I like this. He's not actually a Doom target right now. I guess you can apply it to the Sven when he's initiating in, but chances of like a Lincoln's winning you the game to me is much lower than the refresher pickup.
Right. Sometimes you have to just go the full offense option, particularly now with this refresher on Ohio. We could see the double vacuum, double walls.
If anything, I would rather see a refresher Invoker and the Lincoln's on the Darkseer. Mm, yeah. Double wall is nice, like being able to get the second vacuum right away to help your Sven out, but
right.
The Invoker is that big late game playmaker. If you can get the double around the world deafening blast, and one of the big things I don't like about mid one skill build is maxing out both Wex as well as Exort means that AoE deafening blast isn't coming till much later. He still needs two more levels before he even gets it.
They are trying to control their own fate, though. Fnatic playing to win, not just to not lose.
Oh,
they're
no.
Going to push out with this smoke and
there's
might be
there.
Able to take a fight here onto Liquid, but Midwan's going to be spotted out first. They get off the BKB on the Doom. That's not going to be a good initiation, as now the Doom falls on his Sven. He's not going to be able to have much impact at all. It's just going to be left Midwan against two, as both the Invoker as well as the poor Axe are just left out in the cold, it seems. The rest of Fnatic try and retreat, perhaps holding on to just the buyback saves, but it seems like neither one of those heroes have them.
Kuro's just trying to chase and keep reapplying the Doom onto Mushi, who's desperately trying to get back to his fountain. Kuro gets another purge off.
Oh, Mushi. He just wants to get back, but now the Glimpse is also going to be able to catch him. He'll never be able to escape from this Doom as it stays on him all the way through until his death. And DJ will call it for his team. Liquid take game number one.
I mean, Kuro's Axe pick up on the Doom, chasing down Mushi. That was the, like, third fight in a row where I've just watched him completely take Mushi out of the picture as a four position support. When you can negate the impact of your opposing team's super carry Sven, you're getting a lot of value out of that Doom. That is something we just haven't seen from most Doom picks in this tournament.
Yeah, definitely the interesting, like, Aghanim's was very effective in this regard, and it seemed like Fnatic struggled to be able to find a way to be able to counter it. Mushi, certainly perhaps with the pressure of the stage here in this elimination match, making some unfortunate misplays. Fnatic gonna need to clean up their game a whole lot more they want to be able to take on the tournament favorites of Team Liquid in game number two.
Yeah, Team Liquid just played the team fight so well. The execution from Kuro was great. Vata on the Death Prophet was just getting tons of damage out. You had the Lycan with a harder Tarrasque by the end. And Liquid just did everything they needed to do.
Yeah, absolute control. It looked a little bit shaky, that 25 to 35. They didn't quite find as many openings, and then they got that one where they were able to force the buyback on mid one, and that eased up so much pressure. They just took control of the map. They continued to farm a little bit more efficiently in Fnatic and built that over and over and over. So game number one, not the cleanest win in the world for Team Liquid. Fnatic did have some shining moments, but they're going to need a whole lot more if they hope to be able to take game number two. We'll see whether or not our analysts think that Fnatic can make this an even series.
Yes, thank you very much, Capitalist, in the commentary booth. We will indeed check in with our erstwhile panelists as the teams go off for their break in between games one and two. Liquid taking a first game, but it was a little bit scrappy in places. Purge, it wasn't the cleanest of games for Liquid.
I think Liquid was fairly clean. They had a couple mistakes, but I thought Fnatic played a lot sloppier, personally. 3-4-3 was out of position in a lot of cases where the rest of Fnatic was hiding in the trees, and the fight could have gone well if he didn't die at the start. I mean, he had no items at the end. It was like Tranquil Boots, Wand. That's not good enough.
Yeah.
I'm going to disagree a little bit. I think Fnatic played relatively even there. That game was absolutely dead even at the 30-minute mark. It was just, we've talked so many times about the trades by Liquid. At 16 minutes, Mushi's taking, I believe it was a quad, maybe even a quint stack of Ancients. Liquid, rather than contesting, as we saw some big plays in the previous series, yep, chooses to go ahead and take the Roche, get the Aegis on the Lycan. 4 minutes later, they have a huge fight mid lane and get the ultra kill on Fata's Death Prophet. And then it was really that, I'm sure we'll see this in the highlight,
yeah,
but it was really that 33-minute fight where they just took over the game.
Whoa, yeah. You just disagreed with me. You didn't tell me one thing that they did that was them executing poorly. Other than that, they chose to take a Roche instead of Ancients, and then you said with the Roche, they got an ultra kill.
No, what I'm saying is this was a very close game. This is much, much closer than the games than the other games that I've seen from Liquid throughout this tournament. I think Fnatic really did challenge them, and if their execution in the actual team fights had been just a little bit better, I think they had a chance to win this game.
You still didn't say the ways that Liquid failed to execute. Like, I get it that the game was close. I totally understand that.
Okay.
But you said that Liquid wasn't executing really well, didn't you?
So we're going to leave this aside, but I wasn't disagreeing with the fact that Liquid played very clean.
Okay. I'll let it go. We'll talk about this later.
Oh, come on. I just got
outside. We were about to have popcorn. We were about to have popcorn and everything. It was looking good. I like that. Bit of feistiness on the panel. Never a bad thing. Fogged, which way do you go? Which way are you siding here?
Oh, man.
You want barbs in the future?
Oh, God. Is it like that? No, I'm not going to side with either of them. I'm just going to give my own kind of like perspective, honestly. Like, I think Liquid just played like very well, very disciplined. They seemed like they had a nice, comfortable grip on this game. Fnatic had some moments where they shined, but I just felt like Kuroki's item decision in this game was absolutely perfect. He goes for the Midas, which we haven't been seeing too often on this Doom.
Yep.
He goes for Solar Crest, which is just a great item for his team. It was a very specific decision versus the heroes that Fnatic had. It wasn't the ordinary, you know, we've been seeing a lot of people doing the Crimson Guard and everything, which definitely was a good item this game for him, but he did not decide to do it. He went for something different because he knew this is what we needed for our team.
Yeah, Sven never buys MKB, basically, and in very rare circumstances. There's just not enough item slots, so if he has evasion on his hero, he's not going to die as often as Sven, higher chance of him getting Doom off, and he can use it offensively to kill Sven.
Yeah, and Fnatic had a very hard way to really go into the fights. They had to basically utilize all of their spells perfectly and blow up one of the targets instantly. We were talking about it. We talk about it all the time versus the Death Prophet. You have to kill him instantly. But Fata had such an incredible game. We say sometimes Death Prophet can be kind of iffy because he needs multiple different items. And you know, we just keep looking at the replays. This is with the Ultra Kill where they really pull out super ahead. But Fata just had such a great game because he got the Yules very early. And he got his BKB early, and then he got his plate mail as well, super early. And it just, those are all the tools that you need as a Death Prophet, especially versus the lineup that Fnatic has. And also, Liquid just did a great job of just keeping Fnatic on their side of the map. I think it was like, I want to say over 18 minutes, maybe 15 minutes, where Fnatic just never crossed the river. Yep. They just weren't able to because Liquid forced so much pressure onto them.
Like, if you play Sven, you have to win those mid-game team fights, and they were very close. Mind Control saved the two fights ago with the Slytherin Crush, but if they don't kill Death Prophet at the start of the fight, they're not going to win the fight.
Yep, and you kind of touched on it a bit too, how 3-4-3 sometimes was out of position. I felt Mushi a few of the times was a little bit out of position as well. Like right there, you saw him kind of getting caught out. Gods commented as well how he was farming Ancients. He's not even pushing the lanes out at that point. He's just in a very aggressive position, and he's not really gaining too much out of it except for his own selfish reasons.
Yeah, so we actually missed the fight that I thought really defined the game a couple minutes earlier. Mm-hmm. They had a 33-minute fight in the Dire Jungle where they tried to initiate onto Fata. Fata backed up into the trees with his ult active. They actually split Fnatic, cleaned up the top two, and then chased down the lane and got two towers on top. And if you look from that point, 33 minutes, in the next 5 minutes, Liquid actually took a 10K net worth advantage to break open what had been a dead even game to that point. So that's what we talked, kind of what we talked about yesterday from Newbie. They're able to identify a point in the game where if they can win a fight, they're going to take that huge advantage.
I liked how Liquid also stayed like very calm and structured in this game. Just like normal, we always see Liquid. They had eyes of the Ancient stacks, but they were like, okay, we're going to do our own game plan. We're not going to risk going to contest these stacks. We're going to stick with what we know.
Yeah, that's dangerous. If Sven uses his ult and he's going to clear an Ancient stack, by the time he gets to Rosh, his ult is gone. There's no way they can contest it then. Yeah. If anything, that's a pretty good trade as long as you get something out of the Aegis and the fight afterwards, and they did.
Yeah,
they got
and
that
the
ultra
other
kill.
Thing, the other thing, Fog, you brought this up to me, is that there's a lot of risk there in contesting that Ancient stack. Yeah. When you know that you're fighting uphill into a Darkseer, into an Axe, they have a lot of team fight combo that they can bring to bear. Sven's ulti's probably going to be active because he's doing the stack. Why not just wait, take your Roshan, get your fight a couple minutes later?
Dire prevails yet again.
Yeah, 23-12 now on the main stage is the Dire side. And you really saw why in that game. If the roles are reversed and Liquid are on the Radiant side, they're not contesting those Ancients, what trade are they going to get? It's not clear that they can necessarily go into that Rosh Pit position just below the Dire Ancient stack. Yeah.
61-30 to Dire, if you include the group
stages. Oh, overall, over the whole tournament?
Which is astonishing, really. Yeah. We're discussing it with Nox earlier. MVP, Fana?
Yes, because he stayed alive. That's the important thing. If he would have been dying to Sven or Axe in the early game, they could have just lost all their team fights, and then it would have been Fnatic in this position with an MVP.
Hasn't played a huge amount of games, Sven, in this tournament, but he was 100% after 5 games. First defeat. Played against him perfectly, I guess.
Yeah, they had a lot of tools to deal with him. The amplified damage, you could see him. He kind of got crushed down at one point because he didn't have an AC. You know, once you get amped, you're very susceptible to Lycan just sticking on you. And he was just getting doomed every single team fight as well. He can't really do anything. Kuroki's item decision, like we've been commenting, it was
really good.
Picture
it was perfect.
So good.
Yeah, there was a small question. I noticed a number of people talking about it on social media. Was the tranquil on tranquil boots on Lycan wasn't. A big deal, in your opinion?
Yeah, it's a mistake. He was building components of a Vlad's, totally normal thing. You can lock those items now, so you can still buy those items without making Tranquils, but he clearly forgot. You don't want to do that on Lycan. It's not worth it. It doesn't increase your movement speed when you ult. It just gives you armor and regen. He doesn't really need the regen once he has Vlad's, so not good, but it didn't change the game significantly.
One of the things I wanted to point out here, the parse numbers just came in. Over 16K damage for both Fata and Matumbaman. Nobody else on Fnatic. Nobody on Fnatic over 10K. And it's just straight out of the Liquid playbook. Fata dominates the mid game, and Matumbaman comes on late. They're able to control tempo so well behind their two superstar cores.
Man, and I really felt like Fata did even more damage than
Does a Slardar do as much damage as a DP? That's incredible.
You mean Lycan?
Lycan.
Oh, Lycan. Okay, I'm sorry. I thought you said mind control. I was like, on a Slardar as a DP?
That'd be
That's great, though.
You know, it's crazy, too. Like, you look at Death Proctor and you're like, the hero, you know, he just clicks Exorcism and runs around. But Fata plays his positioning
is that
so perfectly.
Is that what he does?
Right? But, like, Fata's positioning was so perfect in these fights where he got multiple Spirit Siphons off, even if he got initiated. We saw in that top fight, one of the situations, he gets initiated on, he throws 3 Spirit Siphons out, pops his BKB, and he goes from, like, 25% to 100% life in, like, a matter of 3 or 4 seconds.
Let me bring a question up, though, to you guys, since we don't have the players in the lobby quite yet here. I wanted to ask you guys, we talked a little bit about it, Echo Saber on Sven this game versus the SNY. We've seen a lot of Svens in this tournament. Paul brought up the perfect record. Go with that Echo Saber, the new item this patch. Mushi opting for the more traditional SNY build this game. Good decision?
I was very torn between it, but Kevin brought up a good point to me. I was like, you know, I like both. I like the SNY and I like the Echo Saber. I particularly like the SNY this game because he kind of needed movement speed to get away from them in those situations. But then, you know, they really do need to blow up the Death Prophet.
Right.
So maybe the Echo Saber could have been better, but that's kind of just, you know, we're kind of nitpicking.
Thinking about it now, especially watching those last two fights, I think early game Echo Saber was better, late game SNY was better. If he had movement speed, he could have gotten away from Doom just by walking. Obviously, Doom had a blink and other mobility, but it's a hard choice. Echo Saber is a lot less expensive. If they just got a good cask or a good chain stun, he could just kill two heroes in a fight, but it just never really happened. And that's one of the volatility things about picking Darkseer's Fen.
Yeah.
Okay. The teams are returning to their booths. We'll take a quick social media question while they're doing that as they get set up for draft number two. First question is, how much do patches or meta affect teams' performances? I think it's a pretty good question.
I mean, hugely, right? Hugely. You saw, I mean, there's a reason that Alliance was the only team to win two premier LAN events in 6.86 when you look at how good Chen, Lone Druid, their signature heroes all were Nature's Prophet in that patch, and now maybe a little bit weaker that the meta has shifted away from those heroes.
But with that said, they also adjusted then. Like, they were the one team to pick Naga heavily going into that tournament. Everybody else didn't see the value in it. They changed the item builds and things like that. They got the value out of Naga that other teams didn't. So, yes, it has to do with playstyles, but it also has to do with how innovative you are. And like we talked about earlier when Alliance is playing, they theorycraft a lot of stuff, and sometimes that gives you an edge over your opponents.
I'll extend the question a little bit for Fogged. Okay. Is it partly why we're seeing Alliance, e.g., struggling a little bit? Some of the signature heroes that people, for instance, Arteezy, would like to play and just aren't valid right now in the meta for him?
Perhaps, but also we do see them maybe just lacking a bit of synergy. I don't know if it's just because of the patch and the heroes that aren't really in the meta again. But
does it play a part?
It does definitely add a little bit of a part for sure. Yeah.
Okay. Very interesting.